All right, happy Friday, everybody, and welcome to your Friday lighting critique. We have Diana on the outside. We've got it's like a mix-up. It's like, you know, we've got Kat inside and Diana outside, and Jordan in a mystery location today. So welcome everybody to the lighting critique. So Kat and Diana, you both have animated shots. So I'm gonna go ahead and start there. Diana, lots of noise on the casing on this. That's, I'm not quite sure what, like, that looks like, I'm not quite sure what would cause all that. It's quite, I don't know if it's like the, if it's the glass, it's gotta be in the material, right? Because we're not seeing it really anywhere else in the thing. And like, and I know it's rendered at low res, but that's something that would be problematic, even at a higher resolution. So it's just something to keep in mind. I'm sure you got it, but,
Yeah, I'm not sure. I thought it was just because the transmission samples were so low, and
it could be.
I guess I'll have to see.
It could be. I would do a test though and render it like maybe 5 frames with like the full resolution overnight or something tonight or this weekend, because when it's that substantial, I don't know. Yeah, it may not be enough to clean it up.
Okay.
I am wondering if it wouldn't be more beneficial. So I love the contrast and the amount of light that hits her when she pops up here closer, but I do think that there's an opportunity to add a little bit more light on her back in here, or maybe just like a little bit more when she's coming down too. I think the position of everything is good. Actually, this looks really good when she enters in here. It's really when she's just back on that corner. I know it doesn't make logical sense, but like, I just want to read her a little bit more back here. And then in terms of... the ruby crystal itself, I'm wondering if... because I'm wondering if it wouldn't be beneficial, even though it doesn't make any sense, for there to be a little bit of sparkle in it from the onset, because it's so static for so long that it kind of loses its majesty. That I think that like if you had a reflection card in there that's just like slowly animating off camera and just like making this like shimmer, like being like just like slowly kind of move, I think it would create a little more magical quality about it. I love the spill from it onto the table. I almost think it would be better to... It's tight, but maybe render some frames just at the head of the shot where we're focused on the ruby, and then she drops in out of focus a little bit, and then we shift our focus back to her. Because it's almost like I'm not quite sure what this is yet, so I wonder if it's like focus on her, then she drops in, and as she's falling in from here to here, like once she gets down there, then the focus shifts back to her. Then she drops down.
She pops that was in the original back. Plan, mm-hmm. But there's not really frames before she drops down, but I think I could do something.
I don't think, I mean, because like the first frame she is, let's see her. Because I'm wondering if like it would just be her off camera, right? Like it would just be the frame before this, which you could just turn her off and then like for... And it could literally be a still frame. It could be like one static frame without her for 100, you know, 50 frames or whatever the timing works out to be. And then she drops in and then we do the whole thing.
Yeah, there's no like room in the audio. The four shots cut together like...
Yeah, I see.
But maybe I can edit it.
You know what? Four, because there's two different things, right? Like there's making this for the animator and making this for the piece, and there's also making it for your demo reel. Because your demo reel, nobody cares what the cut is, and you won't be listening to the audio anyway. So, I'm thinking more for the demo reel side of it. So it's fine for the cut of the short. But yeah, cool. Let's take a look at the other shot. Yes, it's cool. I think the red light stays on her too long. I think I want to see it wipe off when it wipes off on the rest of it. Like the siren light, the alarm light. Call it that. Yeah, I like how it kind of like hits her pretty frontally on the face. I think I like that you can see then the specularity on the outfit. That overall read of a sweeping alarm light works better, I think, for me. Somebody mentioned, and I don't know if this is true, that these alarms are actually mounted to the wall, so they would spin almost vertically and not horizontally. I don't know if that's a thing or not. But something.
I mean, I think I've seen that in movies, but yeah. I'm not sure.
99% of my life is based on what I see in movies, so who knows if it's true. Yeah. What I know about the world. Yeah, but this is looking good. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Just having it swipe off of her a little bit more at the end. You good? All right, cool. All right, Kat, let's take a look at this. So, yay animation. Good job.
And the animator liked it. I sent him the test render and he liked it, so.
Yeah, there's some really, really strong qualities going on so far with it. Like, well, that's weird. Oh, and we'll talk about that in a second. I was like, did the book disappear? Whatever's here? I was like, did that disappear?
Yeah. That's crazy. It's because his hand comes down and breaks into the light. I looked at that last night. I'm like, what the heck? And it's when his hand comes down, it blocks the light that's hitting the case.
Yeah.
So I wanted to know how to fix that because I should put a little still light there or something. So it just looks so weird. I was like, what the?
You can, a few things you can do. One is you can render it separately and just have like the first frame of it, render it as a separate element, or even like roto.
Well, it bounces, so it has to move. Oh, I see. Because if you watch when he hits the table, it moves.
Well, after it stops, you can lock it in. Mm-hmm. That's what I would do. Okay. That would be the easiest one. Okay. That's really interesting. And that's one of those things you would never see if you're just like looking at some still frames. Okay, so there's that. By the way, I want to point this out. I love what's happening in this back window. I love that we're getting like this sliver of light and it's blooming a little bit. It's really, really, really pretty. I love that we're starting to really get a feel of that underlight on him. I think that the position of it right now makes total sense for the space.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But the thing about it is even though it's in the right location, right now, it's flattening him out a little bit too much. So now is when we start to cheat it a little bit. And so one of the, like if I am, let's go to the last frame. Let's go back in here. So like as we get, especially as he gets like down, where's that? Like down in here. I think because it's like it's right up underneath. I think what we can do is take the light that's causing that and swing it more to the left. Because, like, it feels like the desk lamp is more to his left than it would be to his right, you know, so we can get away with that a little more. So even if it's not in this location, throw it, like, over here to create more left-to-right shaping across his face. So it's a little brighter on this side, a little darker on this side. But
that'll probably help the really flat shadow, too, on his...
Yeah, that might cure that, too.
When he's looking...
The knife looks really great. Let's see. I'm wondering, like the fact that we see that flash of it in the light before it slams down is really cool. Steps up, and then one thing too about just looking at this finger pose at the end. So it feels like I don't want to see as much of the side light on the hand at this pose. I want it to be like a really strong rim around. Although it's maybe not. I just want to. Yeah, I think it's more about this being a rim light from this light than it is from the main light coming in from the side. Because I really want to, like, keep all this out of that realm.
Yeah. Okay. Because I had it like that because the light. I was thinking because the light's coming in from the window. I was thinking that it would hit his arm because I do want the. You know, to see the finger too.
Yeah.
But do you want no light on the arm or no. Just pop a little bit more rim?
Maybe.
Because I had the arm like less lit and it just looked weird because then you were focusing on the face and not him pointing. So I didn't.
So here's my thing with it. Like, it's because because the thing is, like, this geometry in here feels, because of the shape of it, it like kind of flattens it out when it's hit from that one side.
Okay.
Could you maybe just test it? I think
angle the light.
Yeah, it would be a matter of just trying this on your own and seeing if you like it. Maybe just for like one frame.
Okay.
Put a gobo here, or a light blocker or something there, so that light doesn't hit that.
Mm-hmm.
And then just put a separate spotlight like back here, and shine it just on his arm.
Okay.
And just to see if we can get like just to see if what it looks like.
Okay.
Just and then but the bigger thing for the next iteration is swinging the light around on his face, so it's more left to right shaping. But this is yeah, the animator should be happy. This is moving along really well. And I like the darkness.
I did have one question, and yeah. I think it's before this shot. Like, if you scroll back real slow, his eyes go wonky.
Like that?
There you go.
Oh, weird.
Yeah. And is it just because the way the light is hitting the geometry? Because it's a weird reflect. It's like what you see at night from animals.
yeah, exactly. Like, I was actually thinking, there's a character in the Men in Black movie that, like, his like pupils blink in itself, or, like, they blink in a weird way. And I was like, I didn't think of that.
Yeah.
It's one of two things, or one of a couple things. I think the most likely candidates are it's but like nothing really changes from here to here. My guess is it might actually be geometry penetrating itself, or like somehow.
Okay.
Just check it. I think
probably
the eye white might be penetrating the black pupil. So you may want to.
Okay.
I mean, we
have
could,
the animator look at that.
Yeah, look at it on your end and see if that's the sclera popping through the pupil. The animator might have to clean that up. Or there are things that we can do to fix it.
It was just such a weird thing. But I know, like, the pupil and the iris and the sclera are all separate, so it could just be geometry slipping.
Yeah, that's what it feels like to me. Like, as the jaw drops, it stretches the eyeball this way. That actually makes it pop out.
Okay.
But I mean, there, like I said, lots of times when situations like this come up, and like let's say this was a 120 hour per frame render that we get, mm-hmm. and there's just not time to re-render it. The one thing that you can do is just render. Like these, whatever these are, like these 10 frames, like 1, 2, 3, 4, mm-hmm. 5, 6. So 6 frames with the mm-hmm. eye white just turned off. And then you just have the
okay,
eye.
Then
you just
pop them back in.
Yeah. And then you like literally roto them and pop them back in. I mean, because there are ways around it. We do that a lot with like fur bodies when they penetrate skin and they kind of pop out. It's like, okay, can we get, you know, frames. Whatever it would be, like frame 50 through frames, you know, 57 without fur, and then you turn off the fur, you render those, and then in those you can like literally paint in the good things and like kind of roto them or whatever you need to do. Cool. But yeah, no, this is looking great.
Okay.
All right, Holly was here. Holly was here a minute ago. We'll do Holly's next. She stopped in for a second. Okay. So Holly, okay. So this is another car driving scene. So we just had Antonio do his. We had Yang do one a while ago. And like I've said before, these are really, really challenging. Is that Holly? Oh, good, Holly, you're back. Okay, Holly, we were just getting started, and I was saying that Antonio just did a car, an interior car shot similar to this. And it would be something really good to take a look at. So the biggest things that I'm seeing is that on a sunny day like this, where you're inside a car and light's going to be rattling around, and there's lights bouncing off the buildings and off the street and everything, the shadows are a little bit too heavy. They're little, like the little boy in the back, or the child in the back here. You lose a lot of his expression and you use a lot of his performance because he's in the shadow a lot. So the way that I would do this is a couple things. Number one is I would, just for starters, I would take the windshield off just so we can, like, because right now there's a little bit of haze from the windshield on it that's kind of messing up our view of it a little bit. And what I do is I usually render the windshield separately and then, like, have separate reflections that just kind of pass in. So that's number one, pop that off. Number two is really think about, like, so we've got the key light direction coming from the screen left side. And you're doing a really good job of getting some pops of shadow in there, which work out really well. But I really need to feel there's, like, going to be a stronger bounce light that's coming in from both this side and then inside the car as well. So, like, on a daytime thing, you'd never see a character quite get this dark on the fill side. So I think that, let's see, I would say like, take a look at Antonio's. You can look at I did a lot of shots like this for a Spies in Disguise Audi commercial. You can look for that on Google. But I would say find some reference, because there's tons and tons and tons of car commercials with people driving a car. Lots of, like, Matthew McConaughey driving in a Chrysler kind of commercials. And I would say take a look at those and see how the character lighting is looking there. What you're going to find is, like, again, much more fill light, more light passing by, reflections on the periphery of the windshield kind of going past, which we can control separately. And then I think you also have a really great opportunity here with this shot, because she does this thing where she looks in the rearview mirror that I think that her eyes could actually get brighter as she pops up along that way too. And then you really want to watch out for like this hard shadow on her face, because it's like, especially right here at the beginning, it almost functions like it feels like a sharp object close to her eye, and it makes me uncomfortable. So you want to soften that a little bit as well. So it's like, you've got a lot of really good elements going on. Like, I feel the motion of things. You've got, and then this car animating in the background. One thing, it kind of cuts through the rearview mirror. Where'd that go? Like, and her. So you can see they can still kind of see the car there. So I'm not quite sure what's going on there. But yeah, this is a good first iteration. But yeah, let's take a look at some reference, add in some reflections, add in some fill values, and really try and get this character to read up a little bit more back here. So good job there. All right. Last on the animation front, we have Aaron. So this is making me giggle all morning. It's just so ridiculous. It's just this big clown face thing that just pops in very close to camera. So my first thing is, like, taking a look at these masks. There's two lights on them. There's kind of a cyan light and a red light. What I usually say in situations like this is I would favor one over the other, making one more of, like, the stronger key and the other one more of the fill light. And the reason why I say that is because they're just too balanced right now in value, and it's kind of creating a flattening of the image a little bit. I'm fine with the double shadow because this is, like, an interior space. It's like, imagine gallery lights, overhead lights hanging, you know, shining down, and it would kind of create that double shadow anyway. So I don't think that's a problem for this type of scene, but I do really, really want to play up one over the other to allow some, just, like, you know, some of this stuff to go into some darkness and really play that up. And it's also, like, it's a little devoid of mood at this point. I mean, because, like, I'm not quite sure, is this, it's not, like, quite scary enough. It's not, like, it's not scary. It's not really happy. It's just kind of in the middle. So I would say to really play up the mood and the motion a little bit more on this. And then for this guy, we'll talk about this in the still. It's hard to say, like, because when something is this close to camera, and again, like, this is a short shot. This is a, you know, second or 2 second shot. And this character only pops in for the last half a second of it ish, you know, the last from frame 45 to frame 60. So last half second. And if you add motion blur, like, these will kind of be blurred out at the beginning. So you're really only gonna see them for about 5 or 6 frames. So you have to think about, like, what you want about the character to read. I think that just having, like, one light on the character would suffice. I would kind of take this one down a little bit. And then if you want to read the eyes, I would just pop those out a little bit more so the eyes are a little more visible. Let's hop over into the still so you can kind of see from that standpoint. Okay, so we've got that popping in. And so again, like I like, so we've got character shaping here, kind of coming up from the bottom. I think that's working out well. I do, again, I want to see the eyes pop a little bit more. And overall, I just want to like, I'm not 100% sure like what mood you're trying to evoke in this scene. Like, is this a kid visiting his kooky grandma? Or is this like something sinister is about to happen? It feels a little bit off with some of the stuff, but I do want to see some more reference just to get an understanding of kind of the visual look that you're going for. There's multiple light colors. There's a cyan light. There's the red light back here. Now we've got a whole lot of warm light. And then back here, there's a lot of, you know, and actually up until now, I thought that we were inside, but seeing the roof of the house and seeing that space back there, I guess we're outside. So now it's more about like, it's nighttime with some artificial light. If that's the case, then we want to fill in with some like, you know, bluer light and see a little bit of sky back here. Yeah. So that really, I just want to check your motivation and to see like the type of look that you're trying to build. So for the next iteration, just let us know and then we can go from there. But if we're feeling let's say we're going for this like moody, scary thing, definitely I would consider toning down this cyan light back here and making it more about the red light and then infusing that red light into this space here in the foreground. Again, if it's just light coming from over here, again, I'm not quite sure what the source of it is, but it could also shine here and create like this hard rim on her face, and then this side of her face could go darker, and then we can kind of play up this bounce light from this side of her face, and then the background could go darker because right now it's just like haze, and there's not a lot of shaping in there, but we can allow like the deep background to go darker and then create more shaping here. And then for the character, he would also, because if he's in danger, we also want him to feel close to that danger, which in this case is that red light. So we want to see more red light on him. So just like kind of trying to play up that mood and that emotion a little bit more. So, it's a good start. The whole thing just made me like, I keep giggling about it. So good job with that. All right, Andre. So this one's looking great. This is the previous version. We talked about increasing the contrast a little bit, like getting it to pop just a touch more. I think that looks really good. I think the colors look good. The eye dings really help out a lot. I think that this one is done. So if this is I'd like to add this to the Woman in the Window Hall of Fame area. So if this is your final render, cool, let me know. Send it over. Or if you want to like re-render to higher resolution or make any final tweaks yourself, awesome. Just send it over and I'll add it to the Hall of Fame. So really good job there. Jeremy. So this is taking a little bit of a turn from the previous version. You can see, like, I'm just looking at my own face as I pop in here, and I'm like, I'm going very red. So that is cool. So the one thing that you mentioned that before really tackling anything else, is I want to figure out what's going on with why we can't see the light through the windows. Because I think that'll really, really play up. I think that'll really, really make an impact. So the things to check would be to check the, so if we put a light in here and the light's not shining through, there's a couple things that could cause that. Number one is like that there's there's not enough transparency in the shader of the window. There's not enough rays, because like what'll happen is, like, let's say there's a double pane of glass there and you have the rays only passing through one refraction ray, that'll actually hit that, go to refract, and not actually continue onward. So I'm curious as to what's going on there. I'm guessing it's more about the shader of the window itself, because I think that will, because now we're kind of getting into a Blade Runner type feel where there's like haze and there's color, and like getting that color to get some compliments inside those windows would be really good. And then the other thing that is very cool when you do that is if you can add some simple shapes in there or something to kind of break up, because you don't want, the more and more I look at, like, I look out my windows at night and I look at the other buildings, you can just see that they're like, you never just see like a solid color. It's like you see the position of the light, then you'll maybe see like a little lamp here on the window. Over here you'll see like, you know, someone still has their Christmas tree up, and like up over here it'll be like there'll actually be a desk lamp, and then there'll be some curtains or something, and like, but there's more, there's like some detail in there, and you don't have to like fully, you know, model curtains or whatever. You can just do simple shapes and just something to break that up. But overall, this has got like a much moodier feel to it now. But before going any further, I want you to take a look at that, possibly post to the help channels, so we can help diagnose what's going on there, and like talk about like what you're trying and what you've tried to fix the problem. And I think that'll really help. All right, Montgomery, I think this looks really good. I don't really have any other notes on this. I think this ended up going really, really well. I think the character's looking really nice. I think, again, for first character lighting assignment, you killed it. So really great job. I will also add this, and this one actually in Sonics as well. I'll go ahead and throw both of these into the additional. Although actually looking at this one, Sonic, I think there's like an inch of brightness more we can go, like just a touch, and that's it. But I wanted to bring this one up again with your previous version, and then like when you guys are done with those, send those over. We'll get those added as well. And the other thing too that I wanted to call attention to was your question from yesterday, which was, because yesterday I was just doing some paint overs and some like taking them into Photoshop and just sliding values around, and you asked a question of like, is it good enough to just increase the contrast in post, and is that good enough? And sometimes yes, but with the value difference, like what I just did would be fine, but the value difference that we were talking yesterday comes with secondary elements, right? So when you increase the light value, it's increasing the bounces, it's increasing some of those secondary looks to it, it's increasing the reflections, it's increase, like there's some secondary things that happen in there that could be kind of crucial to how it looks. So if it's like a minor tweak, like again, like if you're just like making the saturation on the pants a little bit more, then that's totally fine. But if you're making them from like dark yellow to bright yellow, or yellow to like magenta, you definitely want to do that in the renderer, because what could happen is if there's like a reflective element, or like say that this hand, because this hand is getting a little bit of bounce from that, if that changes color in the comp, this is still going to look yellow, and now this will look magenta, and it won't match up. So that's all I was going to say. It was just like, if you can do it in the render, do it in the render. If not, a simple tweak in the comp is totally fine too. All right, that is it for today. Everybody who is around this weekend, make sure you submit to the general work in progress and feedback channel. Diana and George and Forrest are hosting another Academy of Animated Art community chat and critique, the AACCC, or just the community critique, I think is better. So check that out. Join in this Saturday. If you're unable to make it, they will be sending me the recording, and we will be posting that to our YouTube channel as well. So have a wonderful weekend, everybody, if I don't talk to you. And until then, I will see you all on Monday. All right. Happy lighting, everybody.